All right, my name is Hyunsun Park. I'm in charge of business development operation at PharmAbcine, and thanks for joining the session today. PharmAbcine is a biotech company located in Daejeon, South Korea. We are developing antibody therapeutics in the area of oncology and neovascular eye diseases. PharmAbcine is a public company listed in Kosdaq stock exchange market, and current market cap is $171 million. We have one clinical asset, Olinvacimab, which is a tumor angiogenesis inhibitor targeting VEGF receptor 2. Olinvacimab has a best-in-class potential, and it is currently in two phase 2 clinical studies. We have two late-stage preclinical assets. One is PMC-309, an anti-VISTA antibody, and PMC-403, a Tie2 activated antibody that we are planning to file IND toward the end of this year. So we are actively looking for the opportunity to license out our clinical asset, Olinvacimab, for the early licensing out opportunity or co-development opportunity for two preclinical asset, PMC-309 and PMC-403. So this is our current developmental status of the three assets that I just introduced to you. Olinvacimab, PharmAbcine previously ran a phase 2A clinical study in RGBM, and we are running Olinvacimab mono clinical study in Avastin refractory RGBM, and the sites are in the United States and Australia. And we ran two Olinvacimab Keytruda combo phase 1B study, one in MTMBC patients, and we are finishing up the phase 1B, and meanwhile we started a phase 2 clinical study, and the sites are in the Australia. And we just completed the treatment of all the patients recruited in the trial for the RGBM study. And I'm going to show you the summary of the interim data. PMC-403, we are developing to treat neovascular eye diseases such as wet AMD, diabetes, vitreous retinopathy, and DME. And we are planning to file an IND for wet AMD toward the end of this year. We are also developing PMC-403 to treat solid tumors. Anti-VISTA antibody PMC-309, we are also planning to file IND sometime this year as well. So I am going to introduce some of the clinical data for the Olinvacimab. There are other either biologics or small molecule inhibiting tyrosine kinases that also inhibits VEGF signaling in the market. So the one clear difference of differentiation factor for the Olinvacimab is its safety profile. Other VEGF ligand or the signaling targeting molecules, they are all associated can be life-threatening side effects. They are grade 3 and 4, such as hypertension and perforation of inner layer of gut or the other inner membrane, as well as proteinuria, etc. So far, we have not observed any serious adverse events such as those. One adverse event that is common to Olinvacimab is hemangioma. Most of time is grade 1 or 2 and is reversible, meaning that once the treatment is done, hemangioma disappears. So this is a summary from a previous phase 2A study in RGBM, Olinvacimab mono study. We observe about 25% disease controlling rate, the SD, stable disease as a best response. In 42% patients, we saw edema relief. And in some patients, we observed tumor reduction, cutting down steroid usage. And remarkably, one patient survived up to maximum 525 days. And this data was very encouraging because, as many of you know, that RGBM has the worst prognosis among all the other cancers. So based on this result, Olinvacimab received ODD status from US FDA as well as Korean regulatory agency. And the phase two study for the vaccine refractory RGBM, so far we recruited 15 out of 36 patients. So I'm going to go brief quickly about the interim data from Olinvacimab Keytruda combo phase 1b study in RGBM patients. This study has been completed. The treatment has been completed and we are following up on one patient. So total, there are 9 patients who were recruited and there were 2 cohorts. The first cohort was treated with 12 mg per kg Olinvacimab, second treated with 16 mg per kg Olinvacimab, and Keytruda was at 200 mg flat dose. And there was no DLT and this combo treatment was well tolerated among all the very sick patients. And only one adverse event associated with Olinvacimab was again hemangioma that occurred from 6 patients. So we have 4 patients who show stable disease as a best response and last patient last visit was completed once the 35 cycle of the treatment was completed. So this patient since then has been treated with Olinvacimab only. That patient received over 4 cycles of Olinvacimab as a compassionate use and we are following up on this patient. And this is a summary from the Olinvacimab Keytruda combo phase 1b study in metastatic triple negative breast cancers patients. Now, there are 2 cohorts. First cohort was treated with 12 mg per kg Olinvacimab, second with 16 mg per kg Olinvacimab, and Keytruda was at 200 mg flat dose. Again, there's no DLT. The combination therapy was well tolerated, and we observed hemangioma associated with Olinvacimab. Overall, there are 4 patients who had PR as a best response. One patient actually has CR in the target lesion, but the non-target lesion remained. So this patient was considered to have PR. When we analyzed the second cohort treated with 6 mg per kg of Olinvacimab, there were 3 PR patients. So the ORR in the second cohort, second group was about 50% and DCR was close to 70%. So this data was very encouraging and result clearly shows the shows that these patients were responding to this combo treatment. And we have still one patient staying in a clinical study who received 33 cycles of treatment. And one patient who has CR at the target lesion has been treated with Olinvacimab from cycle 30 due to the side effects from Keytruda. So this patient has been treated with Olinvacimab for total 12 cycles, of which 7 cycles were compassionate use that was given after 35 treatment. So we are still following up on these 2 patients. So this is one patient data where we are evaluating the clinical benefit of this combo treatment in the patients. And it is clear that the patient with SD and PR, they show clinical response that was measured by the changes in tumor volume. So the trial was small, but there was clear evidence of clinical benefit. So based on that, we discussed with the MSD and decided to move on to the phase 2 clinical study. So we initiate 3 sites in Australia and the patient screening is ongoing. We have first patient in on December 24th. And we are also planning to file IND in Korea to recruit Korean patients in the future. So I'm going to introduce some of the data from evaluating PMC-309 anti-VISTA antagonizing antibody. VISTA is a broad spectrum negative checkpoint regulator, which is highly expressed on myeloid-derived cells. So our current working hypothesis is neutralizing VISTA on myeloid-derived suppressor cells can relieve T cells from suppression, leading to T cell activation. We are developing PMC-309 to treat those patients who do not respond well to anti-CTLA-4, anti-PD-1 or PD-L1, and also we are planning to develop combination therapy with other cancer agents, including chemo, targeted, or other checkpoint regulator. So this data came from ex vivo study where we test our working hypothesis. So we isolate T cells and monocytes from a human PBMC, and we put them into co-culture and activate T cells using anti-CD3 antibody. And we added PMC-309 at the same time. And the results are shown on the bottom. PMC-309 addition now increased the interferon gamma secretion, indicating that T cells were activated. We also evaluate the Treg population in the co-culture, and PMC-309, the addition now can suppress Treg population while the T cells were activated. So the result actually very nicely supports our working hypothesis. And we are also evaluating the role of PMC-309 in regulating other immune cells. I'm not going to go through the details. We evaluate if PMC-309 can also activate macrophages. And the answer is yes. In the co-culture, it's a similar setting as the one in the previous slide. We differentiate the monocyte population in co-culture with T cells. We activate macrophage by adding LPS. And the result is that PMC-309 addition now can upregulate MM macrophage and also activates macrophage that was measured by TNF-alpha. So we believe that PMC-309 can play a role in the activating the T cell as well as macrophage population. So this is a couple of data from in vivo models. PMC-309 does not cross-react with the murine VISTA. So the left side came from using mouse TMBC model, which was transplanted with the human PBMC. PMC-309 alone has good tumor suppressing activity. Together with anti-PD-1 antibody, now it has a stronger tumor suppressing activity. We also use a human VISTA knock-in model, which was injected with a human colon cancer cell line. So the first panel shows you the tumor growth over time. And the group treated with a control antibody, the tumors continue to grow. Each line they represent the individual mouse. The group treated with PMC-309, now the tumors, tumor growth start to be retarded. And the anti-PD-1 antibody also slow down the tumor growth over time. Now, PMC-309 together with anti-PD-1 antibody that induce much stronger tumor suppressing activity. We also correlate this tumor suppressing activity with CD8 positive T cells in tumor microenvironment. And it is clear that the treatment with PMC-309 anti-PD-1 antibody or a combo treatment with PMC-309 anti-PD-1 now can induce increased number of CD8 positive cell in tumor microenvironment, while the number of MDSC decreased upon treatment with PMC-309 anti-PD-1 as well as a combo treatment. So this is our current timeline. We are expanding our preclinical efficacy in different cell models, such as a lung cancer model. We are going to test in survival model, and we are going to evaluate the efficacy of combo therapy with chemo as well as IO agents. And we are currently developing clinical strategy and exploring potential biomarkers by analyzing cytokines and TIL in the samples from animal models. And we are running GLP tox PK. That's about to be done, and we are almost done with the CMC, and our plan is to file IND toward the end of this year. So I'm going to move to Tie2 activator antibody, PMC-403. Tie2 receptor is another critical component regulating angiogenesis together with the VEGF axis. Tie2 activation, unlike VEGF, neutralizing VEGF pathways, can normalize, it can repair and normalize unfunctional leaky blood vessels. So the tight activation can improve integrity of vasculature. And as a result, it can improve delivery of oxygen and other immune cells to the tumor microenvironment. Because of this very unique mode of action, we are expanding, exploring the other disease areas, such as neovascular eye diseases, where we have some interesting data. And we have preliminary data from testing in acute lung injury and chronic kidney disease models as well. So this data came from mouse cancer models. The left side came from spontaneous occurring RGBM model that is very good to visualize blood vessels. Blood vessels around tumors are very aberrant. They are very thick and their shapes are very irregular. PMC-403 treatment makes the blood vessel thinner and the shapes becoming more normal. We also tested in CD26 colon cancer syngenic because PMC-403 can cross-react with the murine type 2. PMC-403 treatment alone has a mild tumor suppressing activity together with anti-PD-1. Now it has a stronger anti-tumor activity, which is associated with increase of CD8 positive cells in tumor microenvironment as shown on the bottom. And we also tested the activity of PMC-403 in eye disease model. And this data came from laser-induced mouse CNV model that is used as a model for human wet AMD. So when the eyes are damaged by laser, now you see a lot of leakiness from the blood vessels, which is marked by the fluorescent dye. Treatment with PMC-403 and aflibercept, which is Eylea, a commercially available drug that traps of VEGF-A. Now the leakiness get improved, and that is shown here. The leakage area is reduced. We are also testing physiological response of the eyes in ERG tests that evaluate the response to electric stimuli, such as flash of light. Treatment with aflibercept, PMC-403, now it improved the stimulation to the electric stimuli. This data came from the feasibility monkey CNV study. Again, the treatment was a single injection. So the day two, we inject the eyes with these agents, and then we did assay after 42 days after the treatment. So laser induced the leakiness in the blood vessels in the eyes. Now the treatment with aflibercept and PMC-403 drastically improved the leakiness. We also evaluate retinal thickness by OCT, laser, make a lesion as well as in increase the thickness of retina. Aflibercept PMC-403 treatment now can improve the retinal lesion as shown here. We also measure the optic nerve response using ERG test. And this data was very encouraging to us because PMC-403 treatment using two different parameters appears to improve the response in this test compared to that of from aflibercept. Even though there's some variability among different animals, we are told that this is one of the best response that the scientists, the CRO, they observed. So we are actually repeating efficacy study monkey in a CNV model as well as naturally occurring diabetic retinopathy model. And the timeline is we are going to initiate in April, and we are going to get the data in a couple of months. And this is the data when we are expecting to get the final report. And we are running GLP tox and PK study using eye injection as well as using systemic injection. And that is going to be done in 1 or 2 months. And again, we are planning for filing an IND for wet AMD indication toward the end of this year. And we are developing clinical strategy and protocol right now. So that's about it. Thank you so much, for your attention. If you have any question, please feel free to send me email or directly contact Yafo that we are working with.